Good morning, everyone. Szeretettel üdvözlök mindenkit Brüsszelben a 6. Rijkskon alkalmából. My name is Fanny Hidvégi. I'm the European Policy Manager of Access Now, and I'm very happy and excited to welcome you to the 6th edition of Rijkscom. People from 100 countries have joined us here to discuss the future of the internet, human rights, and technology. To introduce the conference, we would like to share some experience how we see our European identity. I grew up in Budapest, Hungary, as part of a generation that could only imagine its future as part of the European Union. Not because it works well or symbolizes anything, but because we wanted to break out from the isolation of our past. Our idea was that we can be part of a European vision either from home or abroad. And then the current political regime in 2010 gained power, led by Prime Minister Orbán, and they undermined fundamental rights, democratic institutions, oppressed media freedom, and civil society. Hungary might be an EU member state, but the political elite do not respect European values. The country has failed to achieve a true transition to democracy since the fall of socialism. I chose to work on digital rights on the international and European level to be part of a change that leads to freedom and respect for fundamental rights, regardless of where you were born or decided to live. This is the first time RightsCon takes place in Europe. Don't let the sunshine of the last few days mislead you. We are still in Brussels. This is the heart of the European Union. And for some of you, Brussels represents governance, elitism, bureaucracy. But for some others, it is the promise of unity and peace, multiculturalism, and an economical opportunity of a 750 million person market. But as we all know, Europe currently is not at its best. Both on national and regional level, Europe is facing challenges that are shaking the foundation of our societies and communities. Populism and nationalism are rising, and yet EU officials and other decision makers have failed to adequately respond to the concerns that led to Brexit and similar movements across Europe. Human rights violations of EU member states are also left unsanctioned, and hundreds of thousands of refugees are stranded in many of our countries. But these challenges are not particular to Europe. All of the world is facing similar threats. And all of this, and this is why we are here, it translates and is expressed online and in the digital realm, the core of this conference. From internet shutdowns through hacking the devices of activists and international data transfers, this is all part of why we are here. It is no longer possible to separate online and offline, especially the enforcement of human rights. Regardless of who you represent, civil society, companies, technologists, governments, journalists, academics, we all have a role to play. And based on the expected number throughout these 3 days, which is over 1,400 people, I'm very proud to say that this is the biggest RightsCon ever. The number, but even more so, the expertise gathered in this room shows the timeliness and relevance of our discussions here in Brussels for RightsCon 2017.
Thank you, Fanny. Bonjour à tous et bienvenue à Bruxelles pour cette 6e édition de RightsCon. My name is Estelle Massé. I work as senior policy analyst from the Access Now Brussels office. Many of you know that this weekend was the 60th anniversary of the Rome Treaty, which led to the creation of the European Union. Being French from Normandy, where the D-Day happened, I grew up with a particular awareness of the importance of the EU. The EU gave me the scholarship opportunity to study, to go on Erasmus, to work abroad, and to get to know and learn from so many people from different countries. I grew up as a European, but became frustrated by the path that Europe has taken. I'm seeing every day how the failure of Europe is letting the most vulnerable companies and communities at risk. How the gross human rights violation within the borders of the EU are left unnoticed and unresponsed. And I'm seeing the rise of populism, including in my own country. For 5 years now, I chose to write and work for digital rights in Europe with the European Digital Rights Community, which I'm sure many of you are in the room today. And we work together to defend the digital rights in the digital era. I hope that the conference in the next 3 days, it will be a platform to not only address the issues that we face here in Europe, but those of our partners from Latin America, Africa, Asia, and the US, with the experts that are here in the room, to brainstorm solutions together and to discuss what is the role in, what can be the role in technology in addressing those issues. Welcome.
Dobrý den a vítám vás v Bruselu na 6. edici RightsConu. My name is Lucie and I'm the policy associate at our Brussels office. Now I'm from the Czech Republic, that's the language you just heard. And during my life when people ask me where I'm from, I've always said I'm European. This is because, like many people in this room, my life has been defined by crossing borders. Some voluntarily, others less so. And so I'm incredibly honored to stand in front of this room with people who represent over 100 countries to discuss on how these unique experiences in our history have shaped us and how we go forward from here and reflect this into shaping a future together. In the Czech Republic, and I don't like admitting this, but despite a history of basically ubiquitous surveillance and a terrible regime, Czech people don't really care about digital rights. It's not a priority. As a general rule, people don't like making ripples. They don't like bringing attention to glaring problems. And so for me personally, privacy, security, and an overall confidence in our digital environment have become mission critical. To me, European values go well beyond just the missions of and the unifying vision of the European Union. To me, Europe is a mixed bag of both very clashing and very complementing cultures. And I'm very proud to work on defending human rights within and well beyond it. So thank you for joining us.
And now, it is my pleasure to introduce Brett Solomon, the Executive Director of Access Now.
This is the biggest crowd I've ever seen. That was a US reference. My name is Brett Solomon, I'm actually Australian. I'm the Executive Director of Access Now. I first want to say thanks so much to the Brussels team, who work literally day and night to protect digital rights within the European Union for the 750 million citizens. Could we have a round of applause for them? But it's not just the Brussels team that I want to acknowledge. I actually want to say thank you so much to the Access Now team, whether it be in Brussels or in Delhi with Rahman or in Tunisia or Costa Rica. This is where the Access Now team is located. I don't know what time they went to bed last night, but I know that I was emailing with a number of people at around 2:30 a.m. So I just wanted to pay special tribute to them. Not just for the last couple of days and the days that are coming, but also for the full year of defending digital rights around the world and around the year. And I should mention, because some of you perhaps don't know Access Now, that our mission is to defend and extend the digital rights of users at risk. And so we do basically three things. We do policy advocacy work, all around the world. So you name a digital issue, we have a policy on it and probably a strategy to get our policy adopted. Many of the issues that we deal with are on the agenda of RightsCon, and there's about 250 sessions, I think, throughout the next couple of days. And it's really interesting to see, being on the programming committee of the event, like how the agenda actually shifts. The agenda is crowdsourced, so there's, I think 400 sessions or 450 sessions were proposed to get it down to this, and I know that the agenda is overwhelming, so I apologize for that, but it really reflects the state of the world. So there's, you know, issues like fake news, for instance, we'd never seen in last year's agenda. On algorithmic accountability, similarly, it was not there in last year's agenda. It was about CVE and online hate the year before, about Snowden and net neutrality, etc. So it's a really good way to actually check what the issues are from this community. And many of the issues that we deal with, from keep it on and shutdowns, secure the internet, OTT, broadband privacy, and a negative shout out to the US Congress that yesterday passed a ridiculous resolution to withdraw the privacy protections on broadband privacy, ISP privacy, which is just like the first stab by this current administration at the privacy of citizens in the US. Thank God in the European Union we're seeing an alternative trend on privacy protections for users, and hopefully over the next coming period we'll see laws. So it is really up to Europe, I think, as one of the standard setters of the world, and that's why the Brussels team is here. We also do, that was all in the policy area, we also do technology, so we run the Digital Security Helpline. The Digital Security Helpline is a 24/7 service. It runs in three offices, Manila, Costa Rica, and Tunis, and it provides digital security support. Hi. It provides digital security support for civil society actors all around the world. The three offices are in Tunis, in Costa Rica, and Manila, and there's 10 technologists who work 24/7 responding to civil society who are under attack, whether their websites are being brought down ahead of elections, whether they have malware on their devices. On level 8 is the demo room, so it's the Access Now Express, right up to the top floor. There's a demo room, two rooms this year, of tech demos, presentations, and descriptions of some of the digital security threats that civil society is facing. And finally, we do Access Now grants. I want to thank the Swedish government that has provided us with $1 million a year to sub-grant to civil society actors around the world. And that is happening. We've given away $1 million last year and $1 million this year. So they're the three things that we do. And I can't imagine a better group of people than the group of people here to address so many of the challenges that are identified in the program. So let me start or continue with you guys. Please spend the next couple of minutes just having a chat to the person next to you. Make sure that it's somebody you don't know. And I do that because whoever's up on the stage is really at RightsCon as important as who is in the audience. Every person in this room, pretty much, is an expert and can do something about the issue that they're here for. So please take a couple of minutes, and then we're going to start with a panel of some awesome people from the audience to talk to you about some of the issues. Thank you. You've got 2 minutes. Okay, so how do you stop 500 people speaking? I'm not exactly sure. I hate this trick. If you can hear me, clap, clap. If you can hear me, clap, clap twice. If you can hear me, clap, clap three times. Okay, some people didn't hear. So you've each had a couple of minutes, hopefully, to speak to somebody that you didn't know. This conference is on four levels. So this level, the second, first and second level of sessions, and then on the fourth floor is the demo room. So there's going to be lots of people going up and down stairs and elevators, and we apologize if there's any crowd crush. If you see the person who you were just speaking to, please go and say hello, because that person is now your conference buddy. All right, so I'm going to introduce now this amazing panel. So if you'd like to come up on stage, Julie, Mitchell, Marecha, Manal, and Andre. If you give them a round of applause, that would be great. Awesome. Well, can I just start by saying it's an absolute honor to be on the stage with each of you individually, but to be on the stage with all of you together is spectacular. So thank you very much for being here. Some of you have come from places far away. Some people have crossed borders. Many people have crossed borders to get here, including people on the stage. I'm going to start with you, Mitchell, if it's okay. And there should be a mic for each person. If not, maybe we can get one more. So, Mitchell, you're the founding chairperson of the Mozilla Foundation. Hundreds of millions of people use your browser, Firefox. You're an inaugural inductee of the Internet Hall of Fame. Can I start with a question for you, which is, like, are you optimistic about the future of the Internet? Or maybe in another way, what needs to change in order for you to be optimistic about the future of the Internet? We'll start big.
Well, by nature, I think I'm optimistic. So right now, you know, the internet and society sort of reflect each other, and we have a feedback loop of disruption and change. And sometimes when you read history or the fencing in of the commons or the coming of the Industrial Revolution, there is a paragraph or two about how much disruption and change, and we are actually living through that right now. And so still, as we go through the cycles, there is something about the nature of internet technology which is potentially, or in its architecture, more democratizing than other types of technology, like in its core, and I'm very optimistic about that. Now, human nature can take anything and twist it, both to make something better, but also to make it awful. And, you know, we're seeing the whole range of human nature on the internet. And so I think we are in a time of disruption, and that will continue for a while, because the nature of the network and the way information flows and the set of things that are possible now is still early, and so there's a lot more disruption coming, and so a lot of opportunity and a lot of challenges and work. But the actual nature of information flow and the one-to-one and the ability of groups to form, these are things which do have new, real possibilities, unlike, you know, the technologies of cable TVs and so on. And so if you think about all the ways in which the written word, you know, books actually changed society, and you couldn't have predicted it if you'd seen the few presses, this way of distributing information, we're going to see those sorts of changes. So I think we're in for ups and downs, but I think the core nature of the technology and the aspirations that it demonstrates and the ability to form communities is something unusual. Mm. Maybe not the first time ever in history, but a technology that has really unusual possibilities. And we have seen it, and many of us have experienced it. And I think new technologies will come along which demonstrate this. And so obviously blockchain is you know, everybody's paying attention to it for various different reasons, and some of it's not realistic. But it is a new technology which is decentralized at its core and which allows groups to form and track and do things which really weren't possible without massive infusions of capital before. Right. So overall, I think we're in for more disruption. I think this community and the set of people first and building rights for people it remains critical, and I'm underlying optimistic because of the core nature of these things.
I didn't know which way you were going to answer that question, obviously, and I'm really.
I didn't know how you were going to ask it either. So.
No, but I'm enthused. I'm happy that your answer is that because, you know, and scared a little bit as well because you know, as Mitchell says, like we're at the beginning of the revolution. The disruption is just starting. And you know, some might argue that this version of the sort of the fourth industrial revolution, or however you want to name it, started in Silicon Valley, or certainly Silicon Valley has been a key part of that. Do you think that Silicon Valley has some sort of like obligation, some sort of like ethical or moral obligation to protect the open internet, to protect the digital rights of its users, if you do think that, I mean, are they living up to it, or what needs to change in order to, or should we just give up on it altogether? I mean, there's many, many technology companies that are here, and many, in fact, that are not here, more importantly. So I'm interested in your perspective on the role of the technology sector in constructing this future that we're yet to see.
Well, so another complex question, and I'll toss out two or three ideas, and then... let others join. So no absolute clear answer. And I think there's a short-term and a long-term piece. So first of all, corporate actors should be accountable. And you know, in the United States, a corporate entity is a, quote, person. It is a legal person. And yet, whether or not it's a person in your legal system, they are actors in society, and so we need strong accountability mechanisms for them. And my belief is that the current corporate structure, at least as practiced in the large market corporations, you know, it is a 19th, possibly 20th century structure, which is no longer really effective, mm-hmm. especially in the technology side. Because technology companies, you know, we're in this exploration of maybe the technology leads to market leaders. And so we have these companies that are at huge scale, and yet their accountability is A, only financial, B, limited to a small number of people, their shareholders, and C, very short term, quarter by quarter. Like that is a system for disaster, first of all. Because we incent these actors to think in 3-month cycles, right? Which is not how you build a healthy society, and there's no accountability right. in the system beyond that. That's one thing that's an issue. I think in the short term, couple things. Algorithmic, understanding the algorithms, like that's a level of accountability that I personally think we need to pursue.
Yeah,
because it works at such a scale, and what that means, we have to understand. I personally, in the long run, am not looking forward to large company X determining what is truth and what is not. So today, like the push to pay attention to it, I think is really important because we have no other accountability mechanism.
Yeah.
Right. The only accountability mechanisms we have are your users will leave because they don't trust you. Not true when there's only one, and it's kind of a necessity. Or governments will regulate it. Very difficult to do effectively. So the understanding what's happening and pushing today for accountability for the algorithms and what's happening, I think, as a short-term solution is incredibly important. The long-term solution to say that company X is responsible for figuring out if what you say is true or not, I think, is damaging in the long run. It's hard with governments, but if some are supposed to be democratic, you have some access.
So there's many sessions, as I mentioned, on algorithmic accountability. Thanks very much, and we'll come back to you. We don't have a huge amount of time for this panel, unfortunately, but every you know, concept that you mentioned that I think we could have a whole panel on, and fortunately we kind of do. So from this, you know, you sort of mentioned about government regulation and the role of government, and there's many different actors here, and there's a number of governments in the room, maybe 15 or 20 governments are here, and many activists as well. And Manal, you are an activist, you are together with Ale, your husband, two of the faces of the Egyptian revolution. Manal and I met a number of years ago in and around Tahrir Square during the Arab Spring. And Ale also spoke on this stage in Silicon Valley back in the first event in 2011. It is not my pleasure to say that he's actually still in prison after he returned from RightsCon. Not because of being at RightsCon, there was a summons that was given to him before he left, and he has been in and out of prison. So Manal, and every year we pay tribute to him, and often Ale will send something if he can to us. This year Manal actually came to speak for Ale and also with him and to us, and I wanted to first welcome you to the stage and thank you so much. Maybe we could have a round of applause for Manal. Could you perhaps give us a sense of how you're doing and how he is? And
thank you so much. And thank you for your continued solidarity since Ale was first here in 2011. He has been in and out. He got out late 2011, and he stayed out for most of all of 2012 and 2013. But at the end of 2013, we started this, new struggle. And just 2 days ago, he completed 3 years of his 5-year sentence. He's sentenced under the protest law, but he's also facing other cases. One of them is defaming the judiciary. And in all the cases, the legal cases that he has gone through, they have all used what he's writing on the internet, over Facebook, over Twitter. He is prosecuted for his offline activism, but they always use what he's writing online as evidence.
I think we have a video of Ale from 2011. It goes for a minute. We'll just have a little minute clip if it's okay. He's being interviewed by Catherine Keating, who is a colleague of Access Now back then.
I'm now going to be officially charged by the military of incitement and sabotage. Mm-hmm. I'm going back to Egypt tomorrow, and I have to face the prosecutor on Sunday. Mm-hmm. They'll face me with the charges and whatever trumped up evidence they have, and nobody knows. They might release me. They might send me to prison. Any kind of extraordinary justice is, very clearly injustice, and it shouldn't be allowed in this world at all. And if you felt any sense of sympathy or solidarity or pride or inspiration by the images you watched in Tahrir Square, then you should know that thousands upon thousands of the people who created this amazing moment are now in prison, by the military that took over the country and is trying to reverse their revolution. There are, millions of people who resist and struggle against an unjust world order. They pay for it with their lives, and that has to inspire me. I cannot ignore the fact that people are moving and mobilizing this way, and so I have to join them.
Speaking of being cut short, we'll just say that there's actually you know, many people, including Aaron Schwartz, who was also on the stage with Mitchell in 2011, who's not here. And I just want to also pay tribute to the numerous people who applied for visas to come and cross physical borders in order to be in the space who were rejected, and the many thousands of people who are still in detention under military tribunal, et cetera, in Egypt. So we had this, like, and I talked about the kind of narrative, you know, back in 2011, it was about the promise of the Arab Spring, even though it was already turning sour. But I wonder, like, how important do you think that the internet can be in kind of allowing one to express one's identity and political agenda, or has it turned into the kind of, or is it turning into the kind of menace or the enemy of people? You said that, you know, Alaa's writings online and his tweets and so on are actually used as kind of evidence against him. And so from being the friend, maybe it's sort of shifting to being the enemy. I don't know.
I cannot say that, but the internet in the beginning was always a space where we could have debate, we could have constructive debate, where people could express themselves and have identities that maybe they cannot express it or be very open about it in the physical world. But this is turning, and it's not just turning for the government to use it against us, but a lot of the time for news, for, I don't know, defaming campaigns. It happens a lot, not just by the governments. And we really need to think about how to protect this space as a space of diversity, as a space where we can express all different speeches and with all its modes and tones, and debate about that, not just try to, you know, we don't like this, let's take it out of online. And if possible, Alaa has written a letter for RightsCon. It's a bit long, so I cannot read it all, but I would like to read a few lines from it.
And I've also set up a session in the library, which is the room off the breakfast room, after this, and we're going to read the full letter. So anybody who would like to come and hear Manal will read the full letter, any people from the MENA region or beyond, because it is actually a treatise. I read it the night before, and I was just like, this should be studied. So maybe just a paragraph would be great.
You do have a chance to influence where in the broad spectrum between these equally unlikely or likely scenarios the future lies. Yes, on the simple question of how to stop using the hashtag Free Alaa, you have little, if any, agency. But on the question of whether the internet is a space in which we come together to enjoy, assert, practice, and defend universal rights and freedoms, you have much agency. Unlike me, you have not been defeated yet. We love this tech because it allows us to be the performers in our own spectacle, the storytellers in our own narrative, and the philosophers of our own discourse. Not an eyeball for advertisers or a demographic for pollsters. Keep it that way, please. Keep it that way.
And the hashtag is hashtag Free Alaa. So it's his first name there, hashtag Free Alaa. And thank you very much, Manal. And actually, like, as I said, there's not just people in this room who can talk about these issues. There's actually people in the room who can do something about it. Everybody here can do something about their little piece. Marietje Schaak, many of you from Europe know her. She's been called the most wired politician in Europe. And for a good reason. She spoke yesterday in the European Parliament in front of, I don't know how many hundred people, there was a number of people there, including myself, to again reinforce the importance of the open internet, the agency of government, the conflict potentially between governments and companies and civil society. And I'm wondering, Marietje, like, listening to these two speakers, like, what is this being heard in the European Parliament and within the European Union? And what are the things that you would like to put on the agenda for this discussion over the coming days?
Thank you so much. It's really so great to see you all here in Brussels at this very, very crucial time. I think all of the speakers from Egypt, from Russia, from Cameroon, and from the United States, but really all of us have different perspectives on why this is such a crucial moment to preserve openness, open-mindedness, the open character of democracy, of economies, but of course, in this context, especially the open internet. And I believe that it is crucial that we don't only look at what is wrong with policymakers. There are a lot of challenges we have here in Europe as well, but I would invite you and encourage you to develop a positive, inviting, exciting agenda. Because I think that Europe is now in the key position, and I say this with no pleasure about what is going on in the United States, but it has really put the spotlight on us here in Europe to be normative, human rights focused policy makers that will have a global impact. But we cannot do it alone, and policymakers are punched from the left and the right, from the nationalists to populists every day, and I think it is important that the well-intended activist community doesn't unintendedly add to this destruction of the European Union. And I think that that's the key message I would like to share with you, to invite you to develop a positive agenda of how the rule of law can retain its meaning and have real implementations that matter for people worldwide in a hyper-connected world.
Awesome. I think that's right. I think many of us as, I mean, I speak as a civil society member, as an activist, like the framing can often be like, what is wrong? What is the problem? What is the issue? Like, and often when we do our policy work and our advocacy work, we start with the boost to the right to freedom of expression has been so magnificent over the last 10 years. Like, we're often focusing on all of the problems, but it's true. Like, you think about the hundreds of millions of people in villages across, you know, every continent, women who would not necessarily have a voice, LGBT activists who are able to express their identity. So there is so much. And there's also politicians like yourself who are listening. There are many, you know, we managed a whole group of civil society actors in the US to shift the way that Congress voted. It was very close, actually, on this broadband ISP privacy rule. So there is points of influence and there is shaping. And I think part of it is about the digital economy as well as digital rights as well. But you can't do that if the internet is shut down. And that's why I've asked Julie to join us, because she is now the executive director of Internet Sans Frontières, which is a new position for her. Very exciting. But you've been a tireless fighter for keeping the internet not just open, but actually the internet on. And maybe you could just tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, unfortunately, very recently, more and more governments have realized that you can stifle dissent, you can stop mobilization, you can silence criticism and counter the openness that the internet has brought in their very closed societies by shutting down completely access to international bandwidth. I'm saying that, unfortunately, more and more states have been doing so because Internet Sans Frontières is a member of the Keep It On coalition, which was launched last year during RightsCon in San Francisco. We've witnessed that. There has been a leapfrog in shutting down the internet, basically. And very worryingly, in Africa, a continent which is praised for being one of the next frontiers of internet and of connectivity, but we are realizing that more and more states do not necessarily share that view. I will name some of those states. Last year, the Democratic Republic of Congo, the Republic of Congo, Chad, Mali, Gabon in Central Africa, and this year, Cameroon, which is my country, where since January 17th January this year, 20% of the population has been completely cut from the internet. They cannot use WhatsApp, but more importantly, banks cannot work, startups cannot work. There is a huge digital economy that was blossoming in those specific regions, which are the northwest and the southwest of Cameroon, but they are completely shut down just for political reasons, just because 20% of the population has been complaining against bad governance in Cameroon and against marginalization. So the challenge here for the community gathered here is to understand that it's not because it's happening in Cameroon that it's just Cameroon. It's not just Cameroon. First of all, because of the infrastructure of internet, we realize that we are all interconnected. If something is wrong in Cameroon, you never know. Tomorrow could be wrong. I don't know where. I saw a video of Donald Trump, the US president, saying that sometimes the internet should be closed off, I think he said. So that's a very worrying signal. So if we're silent on what's happening in India also, where there have been many shutdowns, and in Cameroon and all these other places, it means that, well, it will be okay to do it elsewhere, even in democracies. So that's why it's important to have these discussions here to see how to push back and how to make a strong statement, even from the EU. It would be very important. Unfortunately, the EU and Cameroon case has been not been very vocal, but it's also because we haven't reached out specific to you, and we're happy to do so. But
we're doing. It's good to use this opportunity to do some lobbying. I encourage that. And I will say, actually, in the European Parliament yesterday, we did discuss the Cameroon shutdown. So. Can I keep going if you...
Yes, no, I was just to finish. The importance of this gathering is to understand what works and what doesn't. We've realized that talking about human rights does work in our communities, but not necessarily for people who, you know, for them freedom of expression is for granted. You know, people here, they can express, so they don't understand how you can prevent someone from speaking, most of the people. So, but whenever you tell them that you cannot text your mom through WhatsApp for 2 months just because a government has decided that you don't have the right to do so, or you don't have the right to earn legally your with dignity your money through your startup, that does ring a bell. And even in the business community, which is very mobilized on the issue of connecting the next billion, how can you connect the next billion where the internet is so unstable, when governments can shut it down for no reason? And most importantly, internet service providers need to be, to jump in this fight as well against internet shutdown. So
there's a whole internet shutdown summit that's happening as a track through RightsCon. It's called the Shutdown Summit. It's launched this morning, I think, after this opening ceremony. I think there's 6 or 8 sessions. There's 200 people in the Keep It On, 200 organizations in the Keep It On coalition, which coordinates daily. And I will say that the definition of an internet shutdown actually happened as a multi-stakeholder session here at RightsCon, which has then been translated into a resolution that happened at the Human Rights Council. A few months back in session 33, I think it was, in Geneva. We now have a definition based, to some extent, on the discussion that happened here at RightsCon, and it says that internet shutdowns are a violation of international human rights law, and it condemns them, and it calls on governments to unequivocally desist on this. So we wish you all the best, and please, people, join the Shutdown Summit. To our final speaker, Andre, I don't know where to start with you because, you have so much to say on the context of Europe and Russia. You wrote with your partner, Irina, The Red Web, which is like the sort of one of the Bibles of understanding the Russian hacking environment. It's obviously the $64 billion question in relation to, this... the relationship between the US and Russia and the US election. We're not going to have an opportunity right now to talk about all of that, but it would be good to understand the kind of, maybe the nefarious web, like what's happening on the underside, thinking about like, and the relationship, how it is affecting the relationship between states, because it is about the individual and their startup, but it's now a question of international diplomacy and the future of the relationships between sovereign states.
Well, what we need to understand about these relationships is that The Kremlin might be not extremely good at in terms of technology, and inside of the country they still have problems with, say, mass surveillance. They mostly do targeted surveillance. So they have some problems, but they are extremely good at two things. And the one is they're extremely good at sending a message of intimidation. Sometimes they send people to jail, sometimes they just block websites, sometimes they do ways of that, but actually, in terms of political stability, it might be extremely effective. Sometimes not, like on Sunday we got protests in 82 towns in Russia, which was an amazing thing, and unprecedented for maybe 5 years. So it's something really good happening. And the second thing, the second point I wanted to make is, and why it's important is, what we have at the same time a vibrant IT industry in Russia, and we have world leaders, and we have antivirus companies, which are known to everybody. We have some really good companies providing internet services, search engines, lots of stuff. And the thing is that the Kremlin found a way how to make IT industry of Russia complicit in many things they do. It's partly because we have a very peculiar surveillance system, which actually is a system of backdoors. And to have these backdoors, you should have, if you're an internet service provider, you should have sometimes formal, but mostly informal relationship with the security service. And that provides an opportunity to the secret services to pick up the phone and to ask you for a favor. And we got lots of examples for that.
Okay, thank you. Well, I think, unfortunately, we kind of need to bring this panel to a close, but I don't know if there's any...
Can I make just one point? Well, we have, I'm extremely happy that we have lots of Russian, my friends, Russian activists and journalists here in this room, but one guy is missing, and his name is Leonid Volkov, and he was supposed to talk about SORM, the Russian system of surveillance, later, but unfortunately he's in jail, and he is in jail because we got this protest. He is the chief of staff of Navalny's campaign, and Navalny is the main Russian political opposition leader. And he was in charge, well, actually, Navalny organized all these protests. But the thing is, why it's relevant to what we are talking about here is Leonid Volkov was not put in jail because he helped to organize the protests. He was put in jail because he was in charge of online broadcasting of the protests. Mm. Thousands and thousands of people watched online what actually is going on in Moscow in all these 82 towns. And the police became really angry, and they shut down the office, they raided the offices of this organization, they raided all these computers, they arrested all these people, they're all in jail now. So, but the thing is that now the authorities is trying to make a point that now you need to have all your online broadcasting sanctioned by the authorities. Mm. And I think it's a shame because actually it's against the nature of the internet. How you can possibly ask all people with a Facebook and YouTube accounts to have a broadcast and sanction it. Mm. But nevertheless, we try to make it happen, and I think it's a big danger. Mm.
And I think just to come back to bring it full circle back to Mitchell's point about, you know, the role of the technology company, the role of the role of open source, the regulatory environment that we have in which the internet is flourishing, the sort of the natural nature of the internet, as you said, you know, the possibilities of keeping the internet on, the role of activists in using the internet to shape their political agenda and identity. I think we have so much to talk about over the coming 3 days. Thank you so much to the panel for such an extraordinary early expose into many of these issues. If you look on the agenda, you'll see all of these people are going to speak in depth on, that was a mic drop, I think, on all of the issues. So if you could please give them a round of applause, I would appreciate that. And before you, thank you. And before you get up, Julie, perhaps you could just.
Yeah. So we thought we should have a surprise for everyone this morning, and to kick off musically what will happen during the next 3 days. So I will introduce rapidly Archipiep Mou, who happens to be the president of Internet Without Borders, Internet Sans Frontières, and was also a great musician. And I'll just let him explain what he's going to do.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I will have to ask a favor to someone of you close to the door, because we will close. Don't worry, we will just close the door for 5 minutes when I will play, because the door perturbs the acoustic of the room.
Yeah.
Yes. So, I'm sorry. In 1815, 2,002 years ago, after 20 years of Napoleonic Wars that ravaged the continent, opened the Congress of Vienna. This event was a very important historical moment in the founding of the modern European institutions. It's from this event that we hold the expression concert of nations, because the music of a man inspired the participants of the Congress. His name was Ludwig van Beethoven. Beethoven was also an activist for individuals and public liberties. He knew better than anyone else that censorship was the most terrible attack against the human spirit of creativity, against the human genius. His works, his music, was censored during the 20 years of European Napoleonian dominion. In all the places where the armies of Napoleon went, the music of Beethoven was censored because he was an activist. That's why your work, our work here, is very important, because by doing so, we conceal, we allow other Beethoven, other Einsteins, to conceal and to enrich human minds. So now, maybe you want me to play? I will play a work, a little work, of a man who was certainly one of the most important masters to Beethoven. His name was Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, the Turkish March.
You guys can know.
everybody.
Hello.
So we're going to get, so just wanted to give a quick couple odds and ends as we enter into the start of the conference. So I wanted to start off, my name is Nick D'Agostino, I'm the RightsCon coordinator. Wow. Oh, nice. And this is my lovely colleague, Nina. So basically, we have, you know, not only we have the largest RightsCon ever, we have the largest RightsCon program ever. And so this year, we tried to make it a little more navigable and digestible by creating 20 tracks. It sounds like it's harder, but it's genius. It's actually much easier to navigate. You know, these tracks range from all these issues from the Keep It On Summit to freedom of expression to data protection and algorithmic accountability. They're really great for you to follow along throughout the conference and really do a deep dive into these issues. And in order to do that, we've provided you really a fantastic program here that you have in your welcome packs. And the program has kind of two views. It has a view for you to follow a track chronologically, as well as look at what's taking place at that moment so you can see what are the cool sessions. We've also got online tools, including an online agenda system through our platform, registration platform called Bizabo, and there is an app that you can utilize as well. But we've provided a whole host of different tools depending on what your usage methods are.
Given the many sessions that we have this year, so we have decided to program the sessions across various floors. So we have the 8th floor, the 2nd floor, the 1st floor, and the ground floor. This room that we're currently in, after the opening ceremony, it will magically appear as two rooms with the help of just a mere 50 people. So at the back end, the second part of the room, we will have what is called the hub. This is going to be a really cool unprogrammed space that's going to have some amazing exhibition tables. We're going to have some fun furniture, and it's really going to be a great place for you guys just to take your conversations after lightning talks and panels too. And so we really invite you just to explore the venue. It's beautiful, and we have a lot of cool like nooks and crannies where you guys can just like relax and and have fun.
So a friendly reminder that RightsCon runs on time. And I'm really pressing it right now. But basically, it is a conference that runs on time. And particularly, we ask for you to respect this. And our volunteers have been instructed to enforce this, particularly when the sessions are end, in order to make time for the next session to start. The hallways are a little cramped. And so we offer our wide range of common spaces for you to continue these conversations that you would be having in the hallway. You can have it in the hub. Which is really great.
Yeah, and I would just like to take a minute to talk about our code of conduct and our anti-harassment policy. So, you know, we're here to talk about topics that are complex and contested. In this very room alone, we have people from, you know, various backgrounds, various viewpoints, and so we have a code of conduct in place to help ensure that, you know, the experience that you have here is open, it's honest, and it's safe. So we really encourage everyone to participate and to help us to make sure that, you know, our RightsCon experiences are successful and that there's no place for discrimination, for harassment, or hostility here. So thank you guys for contributing to that.
I just also wanted to make note that, you know, all of this would not be possible without the generous support of our sponsors. It really, you know, helps us put on the conference, and we just wanted to give ask you guys to help us in a round of applause for our sponsors who helped us along the way.
Yeah, and so for more bits of information, just follow our Twitter handle and just participate in the RightsCon hashtag. So there'll be updates like this, and also just some fun, you know, behind the scene photos and little bits of things like that. So yeah, make sure you do.
Oh, you failed.
very bad selfie skills right there. Everyone boo him, boo him.
That'll go up. So yeah, with that, let's start RightsCon 2017 Brussels. That's it.